morning everyone and welcome to this new video. This is one of the rare occasions where I'm standing in front of the camera making an introduction to the video. I'm currently filming a German version of all my acrylic pouring knowledge that I have to upload to my channel. And on the same time I'm doing the same thing for you guys in English, so this is the second introduction that I do just in English now. And I want to combine everything that I've learned so far, everything that I know, everything that you might want to know when you're new to acrylic pouring or just interested in watching. And I hope I can make it interesting for you. I want to start for the moment with the very basics. So just the basic stuff that you're going to need for the acrylic pouring. If you are a newbie and not that experienced so far and have not done any of the acrylic pouring yet, this is the most basic stuff that you're going to need to just have a start, actually. So first thing that you're going to need is a surface to pour on. And you have canvases which you can use. There is some kind of cardboard which you can use, which is just some kind of cardboard wrapped in a canvas. So this is the canvas fabric wrapped around the cardboard, which works quite great. And you can use MDF boards, you can use any kind of plastic. Actually, whatever you want to use for as a pouring surface, everything has its advantages and disadvantages. I personally love the canvases over all the other materials because these tend to bend because of the heavy load of water in the paint. And this is just cardboard in the end. So if it soaks the water up and it's going to dry, it is likely to bend in the end. This, as an MDF board, also is likely to bend. So if you have really thick MDF boards, like a centimeter or so, this is just 3 millimeters, you should be good. But this size and thickness is most likely to be U-shaped once it's dry. So not my really recommended ones. If you use canvases, you can use whatever shape and size you want. It is easier for the pouring in the smaller sizes, so the 15 by 15, 20 by 20, 30 by 30, perhaps 40 by 40 centimeter canvases. Everything above has its own challenges. More to this later on. So it works the very best up to 30 by 30, I would say. What else you're gonna need is some cups, of course. And there are different kind of cups that you can use. You can use any kind. This is just a 200 milliliter, 250 something. This is about 100 milliliters, I think. These are a bit smaller. Or even tiny ones, like these ones. Or if you're going for a large pour, just these ones. You don't really have to buy them. If you have some yogurt cups or my addiction, cotton candy, use whatever you can get your hands on, or Schlagsahne, like this. This is whipped cream or something. Yeah, just use what you have. And these different sizes is quite useful for different sizes of pouring. So it really doesn't really make sense to have such a small canvas and using such a small cup, because you know, you only need very little amount of paint, and when you flip it over and the paint is running on the inside edges, it's more waste than any good for you. So this is why I have different cup sizes. Also quite useful are these pinboard pins. It's not a must-have, but it's nice to have, because I usually put them on the edges underneath of the canvases and just pin them in, and this makes them elevated from the surface so that the drip of paint can really drip off. When your canvas is laying directly on the surface, the drip of paint drips to the sides and everything is gooey and glues together. And yeah, I just prefer it with these pins. It's inexpensive and it's easy to do. And yeah, do if you like, use the same method. If not, use something different. What else is important to have? Of course, as we are going to mix a lot of paint, you're going to need some stirring sticks like these. I prefer the wooden ones. You can get them in a pack of 100 or something on Amazon, at least here in Germany. I think it's quite the same in the US. These is something I came across only a couple of weeks ago, which is a coffee stirring something thingy. And these do not work that pretty because they are quite flexible, as you can see. And if you have large amounts of paint, it really does not work that well. I normally do use two or three of them over each other just to have them a bit more stiff. Not my favorites, to be honest. I hope they are a bit stiffer, but of course it was a it was a package of 1000, so I will be doomed the rest 2 years, I think, to use these. So if you get them, just use the wooden ones. I usually just clean them after pouring, so I just wipe off the paint with a towel and reuse them until they are too messed up to use. One of the most important things that you're going to use is paints, of course. And as you might have seen, if you have seen my videos, I personally fell in love with the Artena brand. It's a German brand, so if you're from Germany, you're happy to use it. I have linked it in the description box below. If you are from the UK, you are free to use it as well, because they have their own Artena shop via the Amazon UK as well. I will also make a link to the Amazon UK Artena store in the description box below. For you US guys, I don't really have any good news yet. They do not offer their paints in the US at this point. If this changes at some point, I will be happy to be the first to... Well, not the first, one of the first perhaps to tell you. I have asked them to give me information. So once I get the news, I will let you know as soon as I have it. One more thing to Artena, this video is not sponsored, but I am very, very happy that just recently they made an article about my arts in their online magazine. I will make a link to it here in the description box below. It is a German article, of course, but you can have a look at it as well. There are some of my artworks presented in this article. And if you want to read the text, just copy paste it into Google Translate and it will do the job for you. Probably not the perfect English, but you will get a point, I think. So yeah, feel free to have a look, and also feel free, of course, to comment below if you liked it, what you think about it. Besides of this, Artena is the brand that I'm using for, I think, I don't know, half a year now, over half a year now, because this is the paint that I prefer the most. It's just my version. If you have another most favorite color to use, just use the brand that you love too. So this is just my one. I also have other brands like this one. So if I need a paint that I do not have in stock from the Artena, I just get it here in my local art store if I need it, and I get some refill when I order the next time. I also have some paints of Liquitex, which is a soft body paint, which is more heavily pigmented, which is a smaller binding, of course. And I also love my metallic paints. These are also not from Artena. I have them linked in the description box below. They are really great, cool colors, and they're really metallic once dry. I really, really love them. What else for the basic? You will need some silicone. Actually, you're not going to need silicone, but if you want to have cells, you should use some. This is the one that I used for the entire 7 months now that I'm doing the acrylic pouring. This is 100% dimethicone, and it's the only one that I found in the Amazon stores that is 100% dimethicone. So this is the one that I'm going to use. You can basically use whatever silicone you like. If you have a bicycle silicone or your car silicone or something, you can use it as long as it's liquid. The thing is, I don't really know so much about the toxicity of these other silicones. The dimethicone is really skin friendly and is used in many body products actually. I don't really know if these other silicones are skin friendly. Most of the time they are a bit smelly. So this one is odorless. I do have a bicycle silicone which smells ugly as hell. It was something that I've used for the very first pours that I did, and it really, well, it smells ugly. And this one was my go-to ever since. If you do not want to buy silicone oil as its own, you can have a look at your hair products. If there is some silicone in it, most of the times it is dimethicone in there. So if you like, have a look at your hair products first and experiment with it a bit. Another essential is a torch. And this is just a tiny one. Normally they are a bit bigger, like double the size, like this. They are called crème brûlée torches or kitchen torches or something. They work the very same. I just bought it because I found it to be cute, and it is kind of cute. Yeah, it does actually the very same thing as the large one does. This is one of the most asked questions I think I get. What this spray bottle is that I'm using to get the cells. Actually, that's it. So it's not really a spray bottle, it's just a torch. But it has ignition problems. So normally I think you should push the button. Ah yeah, now it works, you can see. Normally you push the button and it should work immediately. This one doesn't. So every now and then it doesn't work. So it takes 4, 5, 10 to 20 attempts to have a flame really burning. And this is what makes it look like a spray bottle oftentimes in my spatter videos. It's just a regular torch. The only difference to a larger version is the size of the flame. So the size probably is about this big here, so half a centimeter to a centimeter on this small one. If you have the larger torches, the flame is actually like this, so 2-3 centimeters long. So here is less heat coming out. That means I can go closer to the artwork to make defined works. If you have a larger torch, of course, you have to keep more distance to not burn your paints. Because you do not want to burn your paints, you just want to get some heat and air pressure onto it to make the silicone rise to the top. More of the physics of this whole thing a bit later in this video. So far, for the very basics. If you are more interested in acrylic pouring and do want to follow it a bit deeper, now let's come to the points that you can use or make your life easier to use probably, which is the flow tool. You might have heard of it. What the flow tool is, actually it is a liquefier for paints. I really can't translate it in English that well. But it makes your paint flow better and it stretches your paint. So this is actually meant to paint your walls. So if you have wall paint in whatever color and mix it with this one, you can stretch your color and it's easier to paint with it. So this is nothing really meant for acrylic pouring, but it's greatly working. So what you do, it just mix your paints with the flow tool, it stretches your paints and makes it more flexible, so you're not so likely to have cracks in your paints when it's drying. If you cannot get your hand on the flow tool itself, there is something called acrylic binder. I do not have any acrylic binder left here to show you, but I can make an image how it looks like here somewhere. What acrylic binder actually is, this is the material the acrylic paints are made of without the pigments. So it is a milky white liquid. It is basically the same stuff this paint is made of, but yeah, again, no pigment in it. So if you have the acrylic binder and you have the pigment, you mix it together, you will receive the acrylic paint. This is something you can use as well. It works quite similar to the flow tool as well. Why using these? It depends a bit on the paints that you can get your hand on. Normally these sizes are not the cheapest. So if you have a more pricey paint, you do not really want to use so much of the paint for the pouring, because to be honest, you will need a lot of paint for acrylic pouring. Way, way more paint than you would need for an acrylic painting with a brush, for example. So you're going to actually waste a lot of paint. This is where this comes quite handy. It is not that cheap as well. So a 2.5 liter canister here is about 38 to 40 euros. It's not that cheap at all. If you use too much of the paint, which is expensive, and thin it down with water, it is as pricey as well. So just have a look what you like the most. And another issue that you're going to face, if you have just the acrylic paint and thin it down with water, which actually works as well until you get the consistency that you want to achieve, but if you have to use too much water to the acrylic paints, you are in a way destroying the cohesion of the color itself, of the paint itself, and it is more likely to crack or to feather out when it is drying. I have had this happen before, so I've learned it the hard way. If you have to thin your paint too much, this is a thing that might occur to you. If you use the flow tool to thin it down, which is thinner than the paint but way thicker than water, it has acrylic binders or binders in general in it, so it makes your paint more flexible and it is less likely to crack in the end. So if you can get it, get it. So another thing that you should do in the very end is varnish your artwork. Why varnishing? Actually, it is a good thing to do because out of different reasons. Actually, most important thing, the varnish is protecting your artwork from dust, from greases, from whatever is in the air sitting on your artwork. If you've not varnished it in the end, and after a couple of years, you will notice that the color shifted and you cannot really remove the dust that is on the artwork. If you have varnished it, like I use the Liquitex Gloss Varnish, it's also in satin or matte or ultra gloss, whatever you prefer most. The same stuff is going to sit on the varnish itself. But the good thing, you can remove the varnish. With the varnish, you remove all the dirt. And your artwork is still clean as it was in original, and you can apply another new coat of varnish and everything is protected again for the next years. Or even worse, if something really traumatic happens and there is a fire and there is some dust and I don't know what's called in English, sitting on the artwork, so you cannot see the artwork anymore. If it wasn't varnished, everything is ruined. You cannot really remove that stuff. If there is a varnish coat over it, you're most likely to be able to save it. Just remove the varnish coat and then apply a new one. It is protected again. Another good point of varnish is that it brings back your colors to life, especially for the darker ones like dark blue, black, dark red, etc. These basically tend to dry a bit dull and matte. And if you apply the varnish, they come back to life and are even more vibrant and popping in the end. So this is why I started using a varnish in the end. So now let's make a small excursion into the physics of acrylic pouring. First important thing is how thick you mix your paints. Actually, I always tell to have a consistency like honey, and it depends a bit how much you thin it. If you make your paints thinner or way thinner, you will have colors more intermixing. So if you have a blue and a yellow perhaps, and you have your paint really thinned out, they are going to intermix to become more or less green. So you might have not so much blue or yellow left in the end. If this is something you want to achieve, go ahead. If you have your paints too thin, you will not have any well-defined cells. Cells are going to form, but they're going to stretch way, way more than if your paint was thicker. It's just the physics of the paint itself. And you will not have so much definition in itself when your paint is too liquid. I know that because this was the starting point where I started acrylic pouring. I had just the paints and wanted to thin them as much as possible to be able to make as many pours as possible. But bottom line, I thought I was doing a good thing, saving my paints, but in the end I used way more paint to get something nice out of it, as if I would have left the paint thicker. So if you left your paint thicker, what is going to happen is that you have more definition, that you have smaller cells, more defined cells, and it basically saves you a lot of stress. So why using the silicone oil? Silicone actually is just a medium that helps with the cell creation. You do not really need to use silicone if you want to have cells and use the Floetrol. It in a way helps you creating cells as well. But if you want to have it 100% sure to get cells, use the silicone. In this case, dimethicone. What it does, if you have your cup, let's say this is your cup, and you mix your paints in the very beginning. So you mix your white paint, your yellow paint, your blue paint, and we will do this later in this video as well. And you put some drops of the silicone oil in it. If you stir it just gently, you will have larger drops of silicone swimming in your paint. This will in the end cause the paint to create larger cells. So if this is something you want, go for it. If you want to have smaller cells, stir heavily. So the silicone is going to split into smaller drops, swimming around in your paint. If you layer your paint up in your cup, you will have the silicone drops swimming in each of the colors. Now, once the color is inside, the silicone is going to rise to the top. This goes, of course, slowly, depending on the size of the drops of the silicone. When you pour your paints on, let's say, a canvas, like this one, you will have layers of paints sitting next to or on top of each other, like here. And each of this layer has drops of silicone in it. What is going to happen now is that the water soaks into the canvas because it's fabric, and the silicone, because it is lighter than everything else, is going to rise to the top. When the silicone rises to the top, it breaks through all the layers of paint that was on top of the silicone, and it drags some of the paint with it. So this is going to be the cell that is going to form and the color that is going to have. You will most likely see the color that is directly underneath of the silicone, but if it breaks through four layers of paint, let's say, you will have bits of this color visible in the cell itself. So why using the torch? The torch actually makes some pressure on the paint and some heat, and the heat just warms up the paint a bit and enables the silicone to rise to the top a bit quicker. So even if you do not use a torch at all, you will have some of the silicone rise to the top and create the cells. But not all of the silicone has enough power to break through the, Oberflächenspannung. So the silicone will never come to top, actually. If you torch it and apply the heat, it has the ability to rise to the top, and there's going to be some cells which would not have formed if there wasn't a torch. So this is actually the reason why you're going to use it. And the good thing with this small torch As the flame is way shorter than for the large torches, I can be much closer to my artwork. So I can make even more defined streams of cells, actually. When you have the large torches, you need to be way more above of your artwork, and the heat is going to crush on the entire piece at once. I can go way closer and only apply the heat to a certain area if I'd like to. This is something to experiment with, whatever you like the most. Now let's come to the fun part of the color mixing. As I have told you before in this video, I mostly go for consistency like honey when it comes to the paint. So depending on the thickness of your paint and the materials that you use, like the flow tool or just water, I have to thin it down to the consistency that I need. So this is what I do here. I use some random colors that I just grabbed. They might not be the very most pretty ones when poured, so I do not expect any highlight pours in the very end, but this was just to demonstrate what actually can be done with the paints. So the first technique that I'm going to show you is a regular flip cup, meaning putting all the paints that you want to pour into a cup of the size that you want and flip it around on the canvas or your surface you're going to pour on. This is one of the most common and mostly used techniques. It is a bit random, so you cannot really control the end result, but oftentimes you can get really nice results. And even if the first initial result is not the most pleasing one, once you have applied the torch and the heat to it, something pretty might come out of it. One thing to also keep in mind is when you're layering your paint is the weight of the pigment itself. Sounds weird, but I tell you why. Most of the white paints that we are going to use is titanium white or titanium oxide. And this is a very heavy pigment on its own. Meaning even if you have the exact same consistency of the white paint than you have to your other paints, the white paint is most likely to break through the other layers of paint that you've put into your cup. This is why the pigment itself is heavier than all the other pigments. There is the possibility to make your white paint a bit thinner than the other paints, which will cause another kind of issue once poured, or you just accept the reason that it is like it is. It does not always break through, so I also had some pours where the white paint was staying exactly where I wanted it, but it does happen that it breaks through the other layers and it just lives with it. Now let's come to the next technique, which is a swipe, which is one of the most easy ones, I guess. And the difference is there that you can get a bit more control over it. So what you actually do is just use your paints, not pouring it into a cup at once, but more or less make some kind of structure or texture on the canvas or surface that you are going to pour on. You can make whatever pattern you like, and then once your paint is on your canvas, you're going to swipe it with whatever tool you want. You can use a spatula. I personally love using some kind of sheet of paper, or my personal favorite is a Yupo paper. If you do not know what Yupo paper is, it is some kind of plastic paper which does not soak up any water. You can use it like any other sheet of paper, but it just does not soak up the paint like regular paper does. And once swiped, you can just clean the paper and reuse it for any other kind of artwork that you want to use or the next pour. So this stuff is really great to use. You just put it on there and drag it over it. If you use a spatula, you have to be careful not to wobble or to shake your hands too much, as each of these wobbles and shakes can be seen on the canvas in the very end, and it is just easier dragging the sheet of paper over the canvas than anything else, at least on my technique that I use here. If you make a swipe, you can use a color that you want to swipe with, mostly a very dark or very light color. So if you use a dark blue or a black, in this case here I'm using a dark blue to swipe, you will have this color to be interlacing to the cells that are forming with the color coming from underneath. You do not actually need a color to swipe with, you can just swipe over it and use the color that is on the canvas. It just makes a different effect, but the technique itself is the very same. Once swiped, you will see cells forming, and if you apply the torch and the heat again, you will get more cells. If you do not like the result that you got from the first attempt, you can feel free to swipe over again and the whole process is going to start over again. But keep in mind, the more often you swipe, the lesser paint you will have on the canvas, and the more the colors, of course, are going to intermix. So if you're going to swipe the third or fourth time perhaps, you should apply another kind of color to the canvas just to have something to swipe with.
The next technique actually shows a dirty pour where the name came from, which is pretty similar to a flip cup, but you don't really flip the cup, you just pour the paint that you've layered up in your cup onto the canvas. To be honest, this is my very most favorite technique of all of them, because I feel to have the most control over it after all. You'll have the paint layered onto your canvas, and you can move the canvas around as you can always do, of course, and create the effect that you want. Once you have your paint on the canvas, you will see areas where the paint is thin covered over another layer of paint, and these are the areas where you're going to get the most beautiful cells from, because there's a thin layer of paint covering another layer of paint, and there is the area where the silicone is most likely to break through. So I have made my most pretty pours, I guess, this technique, like my golden ones. And I do have a separate video where I do make the golden ones as a kind of tutorial, so check this out if you want to. And the last of the basic technique that I want to show you is a, well, I don't know if it's really called like this, but I call it drag, because you're going to drag the cup with your paint. And this actually works quite pretty. If you use your cup where you put your paint in, you just flip it onto your canvas and make some kind of negative space color around this cup. Normally this is done by a very light or very dark color like white or black, but you can use whatever color you like to. In this case I've used a light blue and a pink metallic color because I really love those, and I used white paint as a negative space. What I did, I poured the paint into my cup. And before I started, actually, I made a small hole into the bottom of the cup and covered it with tape. So I poured in my paint, flipped it around onto the canvas, used my white paint to make the background layer as the negative space, and removed the tape from the cup so that the air is actually going in and the paint can flow out. And then once done, you just drag your cup full of paint over the canvas. So your paint is actually going to flow out of the cup and underneath your surface negative space color that you've used. And so you can create cool effects. You can decide if you use silicone or not. In this case, I did not use so much silicone after all. I put some of it in the metallic colors, but I did not put any of the silicone into my negative space color. So then you can move the paint around and see the result that is going to form. You can torch it, of course. And as I did here, I used a straw to blow the paints around just to get some more interesting shapes and results to look at. Two more questions that I would like to address is one of the questions that I'm often getting. Can you use the same techniques for very large canvases? I would probably say not so much, because the paint reacts the very same on large canvases as it does on smaller ones, meaning once poured out of the cup, cells are going to form. But on larger canvases, you cannot just throw a large bucket of paint on the canvas and see what happens. Well, you actually could, but it doesn't do so much good to you. Because when you have your paint on your canvas, cells are going to form, and as the canvas is pretty large, you will have to tilt it way more than the smaller ones. So cells that are already formed on the canvas are going to stretch strangely and make awkward shapes, and this is not so much working after all. So the larger the canvases, the more problems you're going to face. The largest ones that I did so far is about 1 meter 20 by 80 centimeters, and a little smaller one like 1 meter by 80 centimeters, which was my earth pour. I made a longer video where you can follow my process along. Here's just a sped up version where you can see what I actually did. And this worked for me because I structured the canvas onto smaller bits and pieces where I did many smaller pours actually. So if you want to have a larger canvas poured, you can make many flip cups or dirty pours, but I would not really recommend just using one cup, pouring the paint and stretching it around, because it makes strange shapes. But again, this is mostly experimental, so try whatever you would like to do and just work up from smaller sizes to larger sizes. So that would actually be my advice to do. The second question, which I often get, is how you can remove the silicone in the end. Because this point becomes important when you want to varnish it. If you have silicone on your canvas and your artwork, the varnish is not going to hold on these areas. So it is quite simple to remove it. I normally apply a thin coat of baking flour or baby powder, whatever you have at home, and let it sit on the canvas for a while. So 10 minutes, 15 minutes. And during this time, the silicone is soaked up by the flour or the baby powder, and form small clumps, and these clumps you can actually remove by using a brush or a soft towel or whatever you like to use again, and then it takes the silicone along with it. I also use some kind of kitchen soap or dishwashing soap just to clean up afterwards again with plain water and the soap, and you will be likely to have removed all the silicone. Once done, you can apply a varnish and you're going to be good. If in any case your varnish isn't going to cover the entire thing and is going to crack at some parts, just do not wonder, this happens to me as well. Just wait until it's dry, apply a second coat, and everything should be perfectly fine.
So, and here we are, the pores are done, and I hope they were somewhat pretty and interesting for you to look at. You can of course use whatever color palette you wish or you would like to use. I have used plenty of different combinations throughout my videos, so just have a look back at all the videos that I've done so far. There are of course more, and they are coming more and more each week. These were just the basics, and once you get into the pouring habit and you get a hang for it, you will come up with new ideas what you can pour and how you can pour it with and all the stuff. It will come. So far for the basics. I really hope you really liked it. What else I can mention is what you can do to avoid cracking. So once your pores are done, you should put them aside to a somewhat cold, dark and moist place. You should never put it out in the sun to let it dry quicker. Because what happens if sun or massive heat is coming from above, the paint layers on top are going to dry first, of course, and then they're going to crack as long as the paint underneath is still wet. So this is something you cannot avoid, it's just like it is. To avoid this, and in case you need to have it dried quicker because of whatever reason, you have to dry it from underneath. What I actually have used successfully is a hairdryer or a ventilator. So if you have your canvas and readily poured, just dry it from underneath. Use your hairdryer if you want to have it quickly done, or use a ventilator if you have more time. I normally, when I did the large earth pour, which you might have seen, if not I can link it somewhere here, it was a massive canvas, really big one, and I wanted to have it dry a bit quicker, otherwise it would have taken me 3-4 days or so until it's dry, and it was a great block of my living space, so I wanted to have it dried quicker. So I put it somewhere level and put a ventilator underneath. So something that is cold air blowing the entire day against the canvas. And what it does? The canvas itself is going to soak up the water coming from the paint, and so the water can dry from underneath and from above, of course. If you heat up your canvas from underneath, the paint, of course, and the water is going to dry quicker because the water evaporates from the fabric. And while evaporating by the heat, it soaks up new water from the paint, and so the paint is drying from underneath, which is the best way to go, actually. So if you want to speed up even more, you can use a hairdryer, but you make sure to have everything level, otherwise your paint is going to... Yeah, you know? If cracking happens anyways, you might have used too much water to thin down your paints, and so the paints just lost their cohesion. So this might happen. I have had this happen as well. So, you cannot always avoid it. In case you have a canvas that you do not really like and you want to redo it, you can just pour another layer of paint over it. But if you do so, just be careful, because now the paint has no chance to dry from underneath, because the first layer of paint actually seals the canvas waterproof. So the next paint layer is sitting on top and cannot dry into the fabrics, so you have to be even more careful that it dries slowly from above. So, yeah. What else? I have no idea how long this video is going to be, and I hope any one of you is going to watch it until the end. So if you have come to this point, congratulations, I'm really glad. Let me know if you've watched it until the end, if there's anything open and questions what you would like me to answer. Actually, so if you want to see some more pretty stuff, have a look at my other videos. Quite many pretty things are there. And then there comes this moment where I realized that you did not really film your end sequence. So this is it. Next day or 2 days later, I already started editing the entire video, but just realized that I did not really film the end. So I honestly hope you liked this video. I had some information that was interesting for you, probably something that was new for you, and that you can apply for your own artwork. If you do so, please make sure to tag me on Instagram or on Facebook, or just tag me here in YouTube, wherever you actually want. If you want to stay in touch, all my social media links are below in the video description, as well as my Etsy store and my... all the information is down there, as well as the links where I get my products from Amazon, and what products I actually use. And if you like this video, please give me a thumbs up, or even better, subscribe to my channel if you want to see more of my videos. Besides these acrylic pourings, I also have some realism tutorials, which you can find in separate playlists. And other than that, yeah, would be happy if you could share this video with your friends and family and everyone who wants to probably learn acrylic pouring. And yeah, hope to see you next time. Have a great day. Bye bye.